Good evening. I want to thank everyone for gathering tonight. Tonight is a special night in the life of our church family. We believe that God has gathered us, not that we've gathered, but that God has gathered us for the purpose of ordaining two new elders, Doug Collier and Dr. Alan Vance. To Doug and Alan and to your wives, Tracy and Carrie, and families, I hope you will find this evening to be a tremendous source of encouragement and inspiration. To the church family, I hope we will enjoy tonight as evidence of a wonderful and healthy work that God is doing among us as he raises up two more under-shepherds for this flock that we call Chapin Baptist Church. I want to clarify what we mean by the term ordination, because we are not selecting Doug and Alan. We believe that God has already selected them. So I want us to think about tonight's service as an affirmation. Think of ordination as affirmation. In other words, as a recognition or an identification that in the lives of these two men, that God has already been at work, has already been preparing them for this ministry. So it is an affirmation. And we can also think of tonight's service as an appointing, in the sense of a commissioning. And I would also add a celebration, because I am very grateful that we've gathered for this purpose tonight. Let me remind you how we got here. Doug and Alan were each nominated for eldership in December of 2020. And according to the process based in Chapin Baptist bylaws, the elders first discussed each name, and it was determined that there was a consensus among the elders that each man was a potential candidate for eldership. The elders then approached Doug and Alan separately to inquire if there was interest on the part of each potential candidate and his wife. The candidates and their wives expressed they sensed the possibility that God is calling them into this ministry. Doug and Alan both passed a background check. We're thankful for that. Both candidates underwent a year of elder training and mentorship, during which they attended our monthly elder meetings, and they attended an additional monthly meeting with me as we discussed the nature and the responsibilities of eldership. Doug and Alan each passed separately a theological evaluation with the Council of Elders on January 9th of this year. And then last week on February 13th, the church's elder body enthusiastically moved that Chapin Baptist affirm and ordain Doug and Alan as elders. The church body affirmed that motion with a positive vote on the same day. So here we are. Doug and Alan, I want to tell you personally how thankful I am for your brotherhood in gospel ministry and for each of your friendship. And I want you to know how grateful I am to God that we find ourselves here right now. Listen to the words of Isaiah chapter 40, verses 9 through 11. Go on up to a high mountain, O Zion, herald of good news. Lift up your voice with strength, O Jerusalem, herald of good news. Lift it up, fear not. Say to the cities of Judah, behold your God. Behold, the Lord comes with might, and his arm rules for him. Behold, his reward is with him, and his recompense before him. He will tend his flock like a shepherd. He will gather the lambs in his arms. He will carry them in his bosom and gently lead those that are with young. I want you also to hear the words of 1 Peter chapter 5, verses 1 through 4. So I exhort the elders among you, as a fellow elder and a witness of the sufferings of Christ, as well as a partaker in the glory that is going to be revealed, shepherd the flock of God that is among you, exercising oversight, not under compulsion, but willingly, as God would have you, not for shameful gain, but eagerly, not domineering over those in your charge, but being examples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the unfading crown of glory. Let's pray. God, I cannot thank you enough for doing the kind of work in this church family where we watch leadership being fostered. Lord, we are here tonight because we believe we've recognized work you're already doing, preparing and equipping Alan and Doug for eldering ministry at this church family. We thank you for that. So, Lord, it's with joy that we want to commission them for this task. We want to celebrate with them. God, I pray that tonight is one very powerful moment of a work that we continue to watch you do in this church as you continually prepare us and shape us to be a church family that will glorify your name in this community and to the nations. We praise you as our chief shepherd. We pray this in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen.
Would you stand and sing with me tonight?
Come thou, almighty King, help us thy name to sing. Help us to praise, Father, all glorious, o'er all victorious. Come and reign over us, Ancient of Days. Come thou, incarnate Word, gird on thy mighty sword, our prayer attend. Come and thy people bless, and give thy word success. Spirit of holiness on us descend. Come, holy Comforter, thy sacred witness bear. In this glad hour, thou who almighty art, now rule in every heart. And if from us depart, Spirit of power, to the great one in free, eternal praises be, hence evermore, thy sovereign majesty may we in glory see, and to eternity love and adore, and to eternity love and adore.
You can be seated.
Good evening, church. It's truly a privilege that I get to introduce these two new Chaffin Baptist elders. They're men, great men. I've come to love them and really had an enjoyable time over the last year just getting to know them, and they've been a blessing to me. They are Doug Collier. Doug retired from the FBI. He started his own business, Apex Technical. He's married to Tracy, has two daughters, Grace and Lily. He's a small group leader here at Chaffin Baptist Church, and a large small group leader, may I say. I haven't sat under his teaching, but people tell me he's a wonderful teacher. He also teaches other Bible studies, and we're just so thankful that he's accepted this offer that God has brought to him. Our next candidate is Alan Vance. Alan is a retired minister of 30-something years. He also taught and still teaches at Lancaster Bible College. He is currently in the mentor to doctoral students at CIU. He's married to Carrie. They have two children, Dan, and of course Dan and Laura are members of our church too, and Dan and Sarah are his children. He has six grandchildren. He's a member of Co-Ed 5 Bible School class, in which he helps teach. And I've really got to know him and Carrie over the last couple of years, and they're just incredible people. We're just so thankful God has led these to us, and so thankful that the church is ready to ordain them. Thank you very much.
Doug and Alan, I'm supposed to give a charge to you guys. Makes you feel sort of insufficient when I see the quality of the guys we've got sitting here before us. I want to sort of add to what Pastor Michael and what Champ has said. Doug, I've known you a long time, and I've got to know you just over the last couple of years in our elders meeting and in other places. And I was sitting here trying to think of what to charge you with, and I was making my own little list here. And, you know, you two guys strike me as sort of rugged, with a manliness about you that people just want to be around you. And that is such a great quality to be able to mentor, especially young men coming up. But with that ruggedness, there's a gentleness and a kindness, and I found a friendliness, a humility between you two guys, just getting to know you. I've got to know that your families are just terrific. I got to see Doug this morning baptize his daughter, and what a thing, and see how you work around your families and what you do and around the young kids that we do deal with. I've heard all of you praying, both of you, and I've heard some of the teaching, and I'm just amazed at what you can do. And there's much, much more, but I only have 5 minutes. So I'm really going to charge you out of 1 Timothy chapter 3, starting in verse 1, and rather than say that I'm going to give you a charge, this is God's charge. God spoke to Paul, and we know that Paul spoke to Timothy, a young upstart preacher in a time when Christianity was growing and churches was growing, and it was in need of elders. They may have called them different things. I think we deal here with maybe a different word, overseer, but pastors and elders, and they were needed. So Paul gave to Timothy a list of the qualifications of an elder, and I'm going to charge you with those qualifications. I'm going to read them and talk just a little bit about them. It says, this saying is trustworthy. It's trustworthy because God inspired Paul to say it. Anyone aspiring to be an elder, he desires a noble work. What a special thing to come here and talk about something that is noble, and you're aspiring to have this noble position. An overseer, therefore, because it is such a noble position, must be above reproach. Listen, he said, must be above reproach. My charge to you is to hear these things and know that God says they must be. Us as elders, you know, we have expectations. Our congregation has expectations. So we have expectations that as an elder in this noble position that you will be meeting these qualifications. Elders must be above reproach, the husband of one wife. He must be self-controlled, sensible, respectable, hospitable, able to teach, not an excessive drinker, not a bully, but gentle, not quarrelsome or greedy. He must manage his own household competently and have his children under control with all dignity. He must not be a new convert, or he might become conceited or incur the same condemnation as the devil. Furthermore, he must have a good reputation among outsiders so that he does not fall into disgrace and into the devil's trap. When I read this, I didn't see that we've got a choice of pick the top three or pick three out of this 8 or 10, whatever it is. God says that we are charged as elders with taking care of all of these and doing them all. And as I said up front, to get to know you guys, that's not new to y'all. Y'all are already doing them, but I charge you to continue. And I also encourage you in saying, continue in your prayer. Continue in following the Holy Spirit where he leads you. Continue in keeping your eyes on Christ. Continue in watching your family and being so close to them. And as elders, I'll just say that we will pray for you, and we will be there for you, and we'll stand beside you, and we look forward to our years together as elders.
Would you stand once again as we join our hearts and sing together?
Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to Thee. Take my moments and my days, let them flow in ceaseless praise. Let them flow in ceaseless praise. And take my hands and let them move at the impulse of Thy love. Take my feet and let them be swift and beautiful for Thee, swift and beautiful for Thee. Oh, take my voice and let me sing always only for my King. Take my lips and let them be filled with messages from Thee, filled with messages from Thee.
Take my love.
Oh, take my love, my Lord, I pour at Thy feet its treasure store. Take myself and I will be ever only all for Thee, ever only all for Thee.
You can be seated.
Doug Allen, I get the privilege of getting to read the Word of God over you. Thank you for that privilege and being able to do that today for you guys. I want to read from Psalm 19, 7 through 14. The law of the Lord is perfect, reviving the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The rules of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. More to be desired are they than gold, even much fine gold, sweeter also than honey, and drippings of the honeycomb. Moreover, by them is your servant warned, and keeping them there is great reward. Who can discern his errors? Declare me innocent from hidden faults. Keep back your servant also from presumptuous sins, and let them not have dominion over me. Then I shall be blameless and innocent of great transgression. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer.
As our pastor has already said, today is a special day in the life of our church. Today we have a new watermark, a day for rejoicing, a day that the church can shout from the rooftops that two men have answered the call to be shepherds to this congregation. I'd like to read scripture before I give a charge to the church of how we should pray and lift these men up. I'm reading from Ephesians, the 4th chapter, verses 11 through 16. And he gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the shepherds, and teachers to equip the saints for the work of the ministry, for building up the body of Christ, until we all attain to the unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God, to mature manhood, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, so that we may no longer be children, tossed to and fro by the waves and carried about by every wind of doctrine, by human cunning, by craftiness in deceitful schemes, rather speaking the truth in love, as we grow up in every way into Him who is the head, into Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and held together by every joint with which it is equipped, when each part is working properly, makes the body grow so that it builds itself up in love. The Apostle Paul wrote Ephesians 4:11 through 16 to explain the various offices in the church and their purpose. Each office we see is shepherd. One of the offices we see is shepherd. The office is synonymous with pastor, elder. We are told that shepherds are often given for the main purpose of equipping the saints for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ. And so what this says to us as a church is that elders exist for our good, for our benefit. And now I'd like for the church to stand, if you will, and I would like to ask you to respond to some very important questions. In verse 12, the elders exist to equip you in the gospel and promote your spiritual growth. Will you seek their wisdom in the gospel? If so, answer, I will. Verse 13 says, the elders exist to promote the unity of the church as the people of God. Will you heed the wisdom of these elders in the gospel? If so, answer, I will. Verse 14 says, the elders exist to protect the doctrinal clarity and pursuit of the church. Will you trust their wisdom in the gospel? If so, answer, I will. Verse 15 says, the elders are called to speak the truth in love, that we may all grow in the conforming to the image of Jesus Christ. Will you hear their preaching of the gospel? If so, answer, I will. Verse 16 says, the elders exist to help you grow and be built up as a church in the love for the gospel and a love for one another. Will you share in their love for the gospel of Jesus Christ, our Lord? If so, answer, I will. Thank you, and you may be seated.
Just a moment, we're going to have Doug and Alan and their wives come up for a special prayer time. Before I ask them to come up, I want to say that there was a temptation in me to explain that when we pray over them, it's not some magic formula, magic potion, and it's not. But I got to thinking that it's a lot more powerful than that. We are the body of Christ, having just taken these oaths, and we are about to join in a moment of prayer over these two men and their wives along their side, and there really is nothing more powerful than prayer. I want to share that thought. I want that to kind of lay on our hearts as we have this moment. So at that, if Doug and Alan, if you guys would go ahead and come up and bring your wives with you and find a seat. And as they get settled, I am going to ask our current elders if you guys will come stand behind them, and if we'll make sure that we have elders laying hands on both Alan and Doug. And then I also want to ask our current deacons who may be with us, if you guys would come up and if you guys would maybe just stand right down here on the floor, just kind of showing visually your support, just kind of gather around on the floor to be a part of this time. And we also realize that there may be some men who have been ordained here or other places for other offices. If you would please also come and join down here at the front. I know we have a couple in here that we've ordained or that were ordained at other churches. So would you guys join us? Come down front. And before I pray, I just want to tell the four of you just to take this moment in, kind of look around you for a moment. You're being surrounded by representatives of your church family. That's a wonderful, powerful thing. Let's pray. God, you are a good shepherd. You lead us well. And we thank you for that. You are the chief shepherd. You lead us perfectly. We know that we can walk through the valley of the shadow of death and fear no evil. Because you, our good shepherd, are with us. And yet you have also, by your design, planned to gift churches with under-shepherds. Pastor elders that you call. I thank you for Doug, and I thank you for Alan, and for calling them to be under-shepherds here. God, we offer this prayer in the context of the sufferings of your Son. You sent your Son to die on the cross for us. You call all of us as your followers to take up our cross and die daily with you. And Lord, we know especially that is going to be the calling for Alan and for Doug to take up the cross, to die to their self, to be dead men walking in the name of Jesus Christ. God, I pray that your Spirit would overflow on them, that they could shepherd the flock of God that is among us, that they could join in shepherding the flock of Chapin Baptist Church, exercising the oversight that you will task them with, the doctrinal oversight, the spiritual oversight. Help them to exercise that well, not under compulsion, but willingly. Lord, I pray that you would flood these men with the joy of the shepherding call, with a joy and a love for these sheep, the sheep of Chapin Baptist Church. I pray that they would shepherd as you would have them do. Not for shameful gain, but that they would be eager. Lord, we believe they've been eager up to this point, hungry to serve. That they're in this position because we've already noticed that by your calling, they've been eager to serve. We know that's not just the case for this church, but it's the churches they belonged to before. They've been eager to serve your bride. And I pray that that would continue. Lord, I pray knowing that there will be days where that will be a challenge. Challenges are going to come. Their eagerness may be hesitant at times. I pray that by your grace, you will sustain them. Well, we certainly pray that they would not be domineering over those in their charge, but they would be examples to the flock, which they have been already. We pray that they would continue to be examples of men who love the gospel, who love your word, who love their wives and their families, who care about doctrine, who care about evangelism, who want to see the right things take place for this church family. I pray that they would be examples to all of the members of this church. Lord, we know that in many ways the attributes of an elder, they're not all that extraordinary. They really are attributes of Christ followers. So may they be examples so that all of our church family would desire to be above reproach and faithful to their spouse and seeking wisdom and the truth of the gospel doctrine, and that they wouldn't be selfish, and by their examples that our people would want to be sobered and well-focused and self-controlled and gentle. Lord, we look forward to the day when you will appear. I pray, anticipating that moment in behalf of Doug and Alan, that when you appear as our chief shepherd, that these men, because by your grace they have been faithful to the call, that they would receive a crown, a glorious crown, a crown that reflects your glory, and a crown that will not fade. Would the hope of the unfading crown of glory, would it sustain them in their ministry? Would it motivate them and inspire them day in and day out to take up the call to shepherd the flock among us? We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. For those who've gathered, if you will have a seat, if Doug and Alan, if y'all will stay put with your wives for just one more moment, we'll let others have a seat. And real quickly, we do have a brief presentation for you. Matt is getting those ready. What we have is a certificate of ordination signed by our elders. We want to present those to you. And also, go ahead and look in the bag. I know when we get a bag, we get excited. Alan and Doug, look in there. I want our church to have this moment. You can just kind of glance in, because I want y'all to know this. There, in each bag, there are two Bibles, okay? Resources that we feel will be very, very encouraging to you and to your ministry. And we think, we hope, that you did not already have in your libraries ESV Reader's Bible and an ESV Bible with the heritage of historical creeds and confessions, including the confession, the London Baptist Confession, which is our heritage. And so we want to bless you with those. With that, I do want to invite you to go ahead and have a seat back in the pew as we finish our service.
If you would stand once more as we sing a final hymn together.
The church is one foundation, is Jesus Christ her Lord. She is his new creation by Spirit and the Word. From heaven he came and sought her to be his holy bride, and with his blood he bought her, and for her life he died. Elect from every nation, yet one o'er all the earth, her charter of salvation, one Lord, one faith, one birth, one holy name she blesses, partakes one holy food, and to one hope she presses with every grace endued. Mid toil and tribulation and tumult of her war, she waits the consummation of peace forevermore, till with a vision glorious her longing eyes are blessed, and the great church victorious shall be the church at rest. You may be seated.
On behalf of the elder body, we thank you for being here today representing your church. You probably recognize from the charges that you received that you're not just observers of this, you're also very much participants in the elder body, in its nomination, and seeing that it performs in the way that it should perform. Will you pray with me? Father, we thank you so much for this day. We thank you for these men who have been set apart. I pray, Father, that you will watch over them, that you would care for them and for their families. I pray, Father, that you will continue to bless them in their ministries. And I just thank you, Lord, for the divine design that you have created for this church, for every church. I thank you for our imperfect participation in that design, Lord. And I thank you so much that you have gifted us with righteousness through your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. You're-